logical reasoning and apply that, you know, thinking ability as an investigator, so that, you know, your mind can get ready and, you know, you can observe yourself, okay, where, in which way you are thinking and what way you should think, right? Because as an investigator, we should not restrict our minds to a certain area, or we should not restrict our minds to a certain biased views or the evidences that we have found, right? We have to think in all possible ways. In investigation, even an innocent can be a suspect, even a suspect can be an innocent, right? Vice versa. So this assignment was just to give you that idea of thinking process, okay? Now, see, ignoring the term this, we'll just go in the first case. So there were two cases in the assignment that you are actually supposed to do. The case one was dead body disposal, okay? So a XYZ area, which is not much crowded during the night time, and streets are very silent. Usually the road is busy during daytime, but during night time it is just like a dark corner with no people wandering around. Okay, a witness passes by that road between 4 a.m. and finds a dead body near a canal lane. There is an interesting area, okay, which is much crowded in the morning, but it's very shady in the night time. What happened all of a sudden one day is that a guy who was just passing by that area 4 a.m., right? He or she, whosoever it be, a witness, finds that a dead body is lying near a canal. I mean, there is a canal lane where a dead body is lying, okay? Another person who passed by that area around 11 p.m. did not see any dead body. So, one thing is that I am, you know, it's a common logic or a hint that the incidence of the body that was there, it was after 11 and before 4. The police was informed about the investigation and the investigation started. Okay. Now, there was no mobile phone or any kind of device from the dead body that was found. No clothes, no jewelry, no identification mark, no tattoos, nothing was, you know, identified on the body. To assist the cops, assume that you were requested in helping the police in this case. Your task is to find some evidence that may help the cops to identify the murderer. Okay, a lot of hints are already present in the case. Now, Khiladi sir, you said that you will be able to, you know, give your inputs on the case one, right? Could you just say me that what you could, you know, what were your insights for cracking up this case?
See, first of all, you know, you're saying like the actually case study says like the dead body was found in the street. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, I'll check for the CCTV if available in that street, because it will be a big street, maybe possible like
okay,
some
sir,
of the
sorry, I just forgot to mention in the case study, mm-hmm. there is no CCTV also.
Okay. My first no clue was related to that. Okay. Not an issue. Second thing is, the phone locations in this area, like you can say maybe, so let's suppose from 10 o'clock to morning 6 o'clock, how many cell phones like were active in this location? Okay. Mm-hmm. That could be a reason. Like we can see, okay, how many cell phones were, maybe, you know, murderer, he did his research before dumping the body over there. Right. Okay. So he might come over there. He searched over there. Okay. This is correct place. In this particular time, no one will be there and I can dump. Okay.
Exactly.
So he might have been, bring his phone in something like that, because mostly it happens like a murderer. He will be not like, you know, he will be afraid of, you know, catching.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. So. And secondly, in that, like, you know, in the locations, one of the location, it will be appearing from some other areas. Like you can say, okay, it's remote area. Mostly the location will be available from there. Like in from like last 15 days, the location was there. Suddenly that appeared in this area and this particular location nearby. I feel that could be lead to an, like, you know, murder.
Right.
Why
now you are very exactly mm-hmm. very close to the, you know, criticality of thinking for this case.
Yes.
And trust me, these cases are actually real time cases basically. Okay, just mm-hmm. They are made in the form of case studies. It's not something that me or anyone from the team have just, you know, came up with a story like this only, like Sherlock Holmes. They are real cases. So you are somewhat very close to the answer, sir. Like how this case can be thought as a point, or how this case was actually solved. Okay, or can be solved actually is. You are very close to the answer, mobile phones. And there is a probability that the murderers are, you know, they are actually having mobile phones, right? Yeah, that's what. Mm-hmm. So just forget about the group or a single person as of now. Assume that there were a guy or there was someone, and there were, you know, these murderers who came upon. Okay. And what happened is they probably were carrying cell phones, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Now, what investigator will actually assist in cops while doing this is the investigator will tell or assist the cops in saying that from the time zone after 11
mm-hmm.
until 4 or 5 in the peak period that is given. Okay. Now, as the hint is given, the street is very shady in night. Hardly there will be a few people who have actually wandered around the street during that time. And there is a unique feature in our mobile phones. Our mobile phones is connected to different towers, right? Voice towers. Now, have you observed, you all people, that when you're actually traveling somewhere, if you're, you know, traveling, especially in tunnels, or if you're traveling from one city to another city, there will be a lot of places in between that your cell phone tower will just vanish off. And in certain places, the cell phone tower will show some roaming location automatically. Especially in India, if you're traveling from one state to another state, you will be applied with roaming, even from one city to another city maybe, right? Such as if I am in Pune and if I'm traveling to Mumbai, so Mumbai is a metro zone. So there it will add me as a roaming, right, in my mobile tower. What happens basically is our mobile phones continuously, you know, is switching through different towers. Right now my cell phone has some range. Why? Because my cell phone is connected with a nearby tower that is around, right? A cell phone tower. Now what investigator will assist the cop to do is, investigator will assist the cop that what you have to do, you have to actually take out CDR, call data record, of all the devices, of all the mobile phones who were connected to that tower near the canal during this time, right? So this will be provided by the telecom company also, right? Now what will happen as the time that has been mentioned in the case 11 p.m. to 4, so it's very shady. Even a normal street also is, you know, not busy at this time. And this, the hint already is given that this is already shady, right? It is more shady. No one even wanders, right, you know, at night time over here. So there will be a very specific set of numbers who are connected to this tower during this time frame. Right? Because the mobile phone was connected to this tower. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is how the cops can actually reach up to the murderers even before the identifying who the body was, for whose the body was. Right? And second scenario, what Kiladi sir already said is, if assuming on that particular day of incident, the murderer is not carrying any phone. Right? So past 1 or 2 days, or past couple of 3-4 days, the same process will be applied, but the analysis work will be more in that case, because there will be a lot of devices that will be actually accumulated, right? So again, what can be a possibility? See, because that murderer, you know, won't come in the daytime to see the location, right? It could be some evening time only that the murderer will come and see the location. That is it really, you know, shady or not? Is it the right place to dump or not? Correct? Because he already knew this kind of place exists at least 1 day or 2 days before, or when he was planning this thing, right? So again, there will be a certain time frame assigned. For example, the time frame, assume that the street is busy since 9:30, 10 till the morning, whatever. That, you know, CDR record will be accumulated by the police.
So, okay. Could be another case, like suppose now murderer is very smart. He put his phone, cell phone at that place, like he just switch off, mm-hmm. he dumped the body and left. So right. In that case, like the dead body is already, you know, you put there, like, you know, there is no clothes, no jewelry, nothing. So this could be a, like, you know, another case, because first of all, body needs to be identified. DNA test. If it's matched with something, then, and something also means the, like, we need to collect a missing person report from the nearest police stations. Like in the 1 or 2 days, maybe someone got missed and they reported to police station, and we are matching. Okay, maybe, okay, we can identify easily. Okay, if she is a, like, you know, girl or boy or whoever he is. So it's very easy to identify that.
Right. The first thing will be DNA post-mortem be only, obviously.
Yes, yes.
Right. The post-mortem will be done of the dead body.
Yeah.
Right. So that's a different part of the story again, right?
No. I'm relating it. Once it has been identified, okay, this person or this lady stays there, that is, like, you know, it's very easy after that, like, finding like a phone number, other thing, email, and very, very similar. Then we can perform a, like, you know, social media investigation, social media chat history. There are so many things which can be identified from that, like, you know, providers.
That can
also lead to, like, in different way.
Right, that also will lead to a different way, and that also will lead to another efficient way of solving this case, right? So, I mean, all these things actually, they do happen simultaneously, right?
Yes.
Because police is not something who's relying on only one method. It's not something that, okay, the post-mortem report will be done, and all these methods will be applied simultaneously, and the most, the method from which the most maximum outcome is coming, that will be taken as a lead.
Yes.
Right. So that's the reason you're absolutely correct over here also. This perspective is also correct, right? So that's the reason, I mean, you know, now you all people are actually getting that this is the reason I was, you know, providing case studies, right? This is the reason. Did he traveled by car? Who can afford to buy a phone in the area? Is it a regular thing? I didn't understand the who can afford point over here. Obviously, it could be a car or a bike or something, because carrying a body, like, you know, it won't be possible for the murderer probably to, you know, pick it up and dump it. It could be bike or it could be car or something. Right. Another important aspect that, you know, we can add on this case. Now, because the location is near canal, right? So it must be sure that it won't be like a regular clean street. It will be something dirty, muddy, street filled, you know, filled with, you know, at least, you know, some garbage, because it's a canal, right? Probably from that, you can say tire marks can be identified. If in case if the forensic, you know, forensic team may found something evidence like that, right? So that can also be done, but it's a different, you know, scenario that I'm thinking of. But as of now, there will be three scenarios, right, that has been taken into consideration.
Can you open my attachment, like I have mentioned some other facts also?
Sure.
Better to discuss with everyone. I'm sure all the points won't be correct, but
all of them. Even you know, my thought process is different, and everyone's thought process is different, right? Everyone thinks that I thought in a digital, you know, manner for CDR. You thought in a post-mortem analysis. And this is what, you know, we want to inculcate, right? Because when we start thinking in multiple, you know, scenes, we actually get an habit for inculcating the things that how we can think as an investigator, right? And that is what we want. You know, everyone is giving their own opinion. This is how the case study will work. Right, so first of all, the dead body is required in terms of the investigation, right? You have already mentioned about the DNA test. Correct. Recent missing person case. Yeah. So if there are any, you know, police report will show if there are any missing persons nearby, right? Murderer would have done some research to dispose of dead body. Here CCTV cameras can be located. Yes, absolutely. Even if there are no camera CCTV cameras within that street, then there could be CCTV cameras nearby that street.
Yes. Yes. Means it's like throughout the area. Like, I think I should mention the area actually.
Right. Exactly. So not at that actual canal street or the canal lane, but throughout the area, there could be, you know, some CCTV cameras throughout the entire locality, or there could be some shops which are actually facing towards that lane. Mm-hmm. And they have their CCTV cameras on or something like that, right? So we can identify that who is the person who, you know, who has been visiting continuously or, you know, wandering over there for a long time. That could be again a outcome. Murderer would have used the vehicle to dump the body due to its mass, weight, and the vehicle number can be identified using CCTV footage. Yes. Again, then, you know, if that CCTV footage is blur, which is maximum of the time it is blur only, so then again image analysis can be done over it. Yeah, vehicle registrations can be obtained from traffic control. Active cell phone number identified during the night time, right? Exactly, could help to information about the suspect cell phone, especially the cell phone, mostly whose location was appeared to be different location and suddenly appeared near the crime scene within the day or the night time. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So this is what you are saying, that in the past couple of days, there will be maximum of the cell phones who are located within nearby area. There could be some certain cell phones who are, you know, coming from a different area all of a together and here are from a different area, right? So that could be a possible case. Again, there could be cell phones who have been identified, who are, you know, switched off for a long time, then switched on again and again switched off for a long time. It's suspicious. Who will keep switched off for a long time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then the DNA test. Yes, that's also correct. Then additionally, if the victim is identified, then social media scraping is required. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Right. CDR, yes, exactly. CDR and messenger history can lead to identify relationship status, right? All these points are absolutely correct. And this is what, you know, it's cool that I was expecting these kind of things only in case studies from you all, right? So let me just check in the chat. Right, there can be additional scenarios too over here. So anyone who has something apart from this, right? All the possible scenarios are already mentioned, right? But anyone having anything, I mean, you can mention the same. You can mention the different also, right? Then let's jump on to the second case. So it is no evidence murder case. So this case is about a rich doctor who was having a good family and he was murdered. Okay. During investigation, the police found that there was no specific evidence as a lead. No specific evidence. There was no lead at all. A strange artifact was that the doctor was murdered with a very specific chemical that was injected in his body. This was actually found during the postmortem test of the body, when the body was postmortem, right? Sent for the postmortem report. During the time he was murdered, no one was at the house or nor anyone saw anybody entering in. Okay. Doctor himself was alone in the house. Cops reached out to some chemical factories who made and distributed that specific chemical. The owners told the cop that this chemical only has to be purchased in bulk as a drum. And there are a lot of various industries who regularly take this chemical. Here also, the cops were unable to find any lead for the case to reach to the murderer. Now, suppose you are informed about this case and you have to find some artifacts for the same. Note, no specific evidence in digital form was seized. Nor there were any CCTV camera inside the doctor's house. Right? Now, and there was no person, you know, who saw anyone entering or exiting the house during that time. Even there were some CCTVs nearby that area where the doctor lived, still there was nothing taken as a lead from there. Now, you as a cybercrime investigator has to look for specific digital evidence. What will you do? Right?
So, sir, I think you have written points.
Rest for the
but case. I'm not sure they are correct or not. It's in down.
Which prints are fingerprints? Any prints? There is no specific kind of print police have found. I mean, see, I am not, denying the fact that these are wrong thinking. You're the way you are actually going and thinking for the print is absolutely correct. Yeah, that's a thinking scenario. Thinking scenario, everyone is thinking quite a lot. That's absolutely correct. But there are no fine type of prints also that have been identified, right? Now, why I'm actually, why I'm saying this is, because this is very related to, this is something that is very unique. I mean, I also didn't thought of it when I heard about this case, right? And sir, I had given a hint in the case study. As a cyber crime investigator, you are supposed to lead to specific digital evidence. So this is a hint, and go with this hint basically. Don't think from the general crime perspective, because their police is doing, and the work of their general crime scene is of police only. We cannot involve over there much. And they are not finding any lead over there. How, as you as a cyber crime investigator, come up in a general crime scene? You cannot. You have to think in terms of cyber now. And specific digital evidence that you can, recollect. Meanwhile, I'll go through these points. First of all, the doctor's cell phones need to be investigated for call records, chat history, CDR history, location history, etc. CDR can help to find the last call information of any unknown call that he or received before. Chat histories and CDR can also reveal if the doctor revealed any death or threat recently. Doctor would have been poisoned via food times which he might be ordered online or called a restaurant delivery at a home. Right? Doctor's relatives who are working in a firm which is dealing with such chemical items can be interrogated. Okay, that's cool. A custodian in a nearby factory or a firm who has access to this particular chemical can also be interrogated if he or she is allowed to enter in an unauthorized CCTV manner. Any illegal of a particular chemical online or social media where murdered would have been purchased, OSINT can help to identify that. He was targeted. It was a murder. He was targeted. It was a well-planned murder. Okay. So yes, these all aspects are absolutely correct. Okay. Absolutely correct. And this is how you have to actually think. It's absolutely correct. And this is what I wanted. Kudos. Right. Now, again, a twist. What if there is no lead from this over here also? There is no lead from CDR. There is no lead from call records. There is no lead from chat history.
I think his family okay, must be,
Actually, this first closely. Point is absolutely correct. First point is absolutely correct. But assume that there is no lead. It's absolutely correct. You can relate to it. And it is a clue in solving the case. But assume that that's not the initial lead.
Because in these kind of cases, maybe the person actually, he already, did his research. Because injecting this kind of poison and where it's very exactly. special, it means that like the murderer was very professional. Maybe he was very professional. It's planned
let
murder.
Let me give you a hint. No, let me give you a hint. A murderer was a 16-year-old girl.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm the biggest clue that I'm giving now. Now, how can you say it was a very specific in a, clever murderer? Not at all.
So, it means
so,
I
don't know why. I'm not sure that why in this case they didn't went for CDR and all. And why didn't they went for, these kind of approaches. But shall I bust up the myth now? Or anyone who wants to add something? See, I have not been solving these cases, okay, but I know about it, so I'm just telling. No, she was not a relative. Okay, so see, I mean, whatever sir points you have mentioned are absolutely correct. And in fact, I'm not sure that why the case was not taken from this angle, okay, right? But see, these few angles that have been listed, CDR, social media, it is very common, regardless of any case that you are looking at. Correct? these are the general points that has to be considered, right? And they can lead to a good conclusion, right? But can anyone think of any other interesting angle? Because the hint that I've given is specific digital evidence. And as an investigator, you should think that CDR, call detail record, social media, this is no way I'm talking about specific digital evidence, right? This is something which has happened in every case.
DDR.
Specific digital evidence. Okay, sure. I'll just wait a minute. I mean, see, all the points you have been listed down, anyone like, Sam sir, Khiladi sir, everyone you are, listing out the best points, right? This is how you should think. I'm absolutely with you all. But just, give you the actual myth busting that how this case was, solved, which is completely shocking. I don't know how you can take it as a clever move. You can take it as a clever move or something. I don't know how you can relate to it. But this is quite interesting because the way this case was solved. I mean, I don't know. Shall I laugh or shall I just, think like, what was it?
Okay, I just want to tell you one theory. Maybe it's very funny.
Mm-hmm.
You told it's a 16-year-old girl. Maybe she was playing doctor and, she would have got some injection from somewhere like that. And instead of feeling some, medicine or something accidentally she got the chemical, fill it and just she tried on him.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that could be a assumption, but mm-hmm. That's not the case.
Yes.
I mean, I'll just be more specific. 16 to 18 year old now, okay? I'm just sorry. I just didn't mention that. We are not specific, but the murderer, who is a girl, she's somewhere 16 to 18.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And we all actually, stop playing doctor game once we are, in 9th or 10th year, when you are already 9 or 10, we just stop playing.
Mm-hmm.
As a kid perspective. No idea. Okay. And trust me, I also had hidden idea that this is how they'll crack it up. Because now what happened? The crime investigator who was in action in this case, what he played or what he, thought of, let me see that document if I have that written. Just give me a moment. There is something that I have missed. Just give me a minute, okay? Yeah, okay, I just recollected it now. What they thought of is, it was a very specific chemical. Okay. Very specific chemical. Correct. And it, as sir told, there is some research needed behind it. Right. So what happened, this what crime investigator told, using a CRPC notice to actually, get the logs of a famous search engine provider near that zone in the last couple of weeks. Get the search history from that search engine provider, get the logs of those search history where the name of this chemical was mentioned. Okay, mm-hmm. Where the name of this chemical was mentioned. The search history provider gave around 900 pages of report. They went through it. And there was a very specific search that was made. How much amount of this chemical is needed to kill a rat? How much amount of chemical is needed to kill a cat? How much amount of chemical is needed to kill a human? these kind of search results came up. Then eventually the IP was noted using the ISP. They went to that house. They found out this girl and they were shocked that how this girl can be, you can say murderer. But they continued their efforts. They called her in the custody for quite a lot of times, a couple of times. And eventually one day that the girl told that whatever you try, you won't find any evidence. So now they are 100% sure that she's the actual suspect. Okay. Then they brought up a search warrant and they searched the house of that girl. Strange thing, you will laugh. As a point of evidence, there was a commode. And unlike any other commode, it was completely black from inside. Total black. A forensic analyst was called and was asked that if that chemical is poured in a commode, what would be the reaction? So that analyst told, yes, this will be the reaction. That commode was actually, broken down and was taken in the lab as a, form of an evidence. Okay. Mm-hmm. And eventually, a few days later, the girl, she broke up and she, just said that I had an affair with this doctor. Okay. And she was, ready to marry, but the doctor denied. And the girl one day out of a sudden told that I want money and all. And for some, nuisance reasons, she just, brought up the chemical in the name of some, XYZ or something. And one day she told the doctor that I want money. And now the doctor also was like, he was happy that, okay, she's asking for money. Nothing else. He was very rich, right? He was having a good life. He's like, hey, I'll just give money and I'll just get rid of her. In fact, the doctor told that a specific way to enter his house so that no one can see. The girl got more happy. Good chance, right? And that is how she, just injected a syringe, when she met the doctor.
Interesting.
So, this angle is somewhat, we can never think of this angle. I mean, if you just see, using the logs of the search engine provider, that whosoever person in that area searched for that chemical. Why should they do this? Because the doctor denied to, carry out affair with her.
Okay, one more question arises. In that case, if this lead, girl was, maybe if she was using any VPN, then what could be a possibility?
Then the possibility could be that in these kind of certain cases, even we say if the VPN is secure, but mm-hmm. VPN providers also give out the logs.
Yes, I know.
Needed by the law enforcement agents to do so.
Yes. So it means the no log VPNs are not true. All the VPN, you mean to say. Some of them says they are in some privacy havens like Panama, Switzerland, all these countries, Netherlands.
Then it will be more complex because mm-hmm. we then have to check if there are any treaties between India and that specific country to share the details.
Okay.
Right. Because, we want details. But what if there is no treaty? For example, if I talk about Truecaller, probably we all use Truecaller today. Correct? Mm-hmm. What was the cause? The cause was, the cause was that the doctor denied to carry out relationship, to continue the relationship with the girl. The doctor told, I want to break this affair. That was the reason. Okay. Now, if you just use Truecaller, tomorrow, if something happens in Truecaller, okay, or if some, cases happens in Truecaller or something, some cyber incident happens in Truecaller, any investigation agency in India won't be able to get that log from Truecaller. Truecaller is made in Switzerland.
Mm-hmm.
And there is no treaty signed between India and Switzerland in case of solving the crime, in case of, cyber crime.
Mm-hmm.
There is no official treaty made for the sharing of information, right? So that again piles up, and that's the fact, you see, right? That's the fact that even a small simple cases can complex to such an extent where the outcome of that case can come after year or years.
Yes,
that's the
even only it reason. Can be more complex. Yeah,
right, it can be way more complex then.
Like suppose now more complexity can be added, like the VPN was purchased by the cryptocurrencies, like without any trace. And right. that cryptocurrency was also purchased via cash.
Right.
Using
exactly.
Tor or something. So it's like almost impossible to crack it.
Right.
So these
right.
are the like anti-forensic and forensic techniques, like
exactly.
how to avoid
exactly.
it and how to investigate it that.
Right. And that's the reason some of the cases, they just, you know, pile up into the files. And, you know, the cops or the agencies just wait until even a small piece of clue can be added into that file again.
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, there are some cases where the case was solved after 4 or 5 years. There was some, so all of a sudden that case was again, you know, linked with some evidence and the previous file was opened.
Yes, yes, yes. There are many cases actually in that way.
And especially in India, there are a lot. No one is as quick in, you know, like solving the cases, right? Because the number of cases that have been, you know, present in India are quite tremendous, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's the fact again. And more adding more to that, there is no specific, you know, fear in the, you know, Indian mindset regarding cyber laws.
Yeah.
Right. And yeah, that's on it. That's true. They, you know, there is a neutralization feeling,
well.
And they feel we are anonymized, and there is a feeling of neutralization that we can do anything on the cyber world. And adding to that point, there is no specific, you know, kind of strict action also taken by the law. Right. And how people think is a few years of imprisonment and out. That's all. Or if they are rich, they'll just pay the amount and they'll just escape out.
Yeah. Even no case was filed for them.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So that's the problem. But we can't help it out. Right. So, I mean, our entire time, you know, went in this case studies only. But I just hope that, you know, you people found it interesting, right?
What about the first one, like conclusion?
A conclusion, again, I mean, this was solved using CDR,
mm-hmm.
right? All these aspects are absolutely correct, but this was solved using CDR.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So during that time frame, the murderer had the phone with himself or herself.
Mm-hmm.
And a few suspected list of numbers came out from that CDR. During that time zone, who entered that tower location?
Mm-hmm.
Who connected with that tower, right? So this is how this case was cracked up.
Oh, that's good.
Right?
And
now,
one more thing.
Yeah.
Just sorry to interrupt. So like while investigation, will you like guide us about the best like privacy guide? Like just to protect us from, like, you know, maybe we will be investigating some very sensitive cases, like they may be, you know, related to maybe national security. In that case, what kind of best possible like privacy guide we can apply?
Sure,
what could
sir.
Be possible?
I'll be sharing an insight on that for sure, right? There I'll be sharing insights on that. More oftenly, yeah, I'll just provide a generalized idea, because when you're talking about cases for national security, then first of all, the agency that you're working for, they'll only, you know, provide you some kind of privacy and some limitation by default.
Mm-hmm.
Depends.
I know some guides.
Right. And
I will tell you my own privacy methodology, which I'm applying like from since 8 years. I'm following same means. I will tell you one day. I wanted to, you know, from you also. Maybe it will be different way, but it'll
definitely,
be very interesting.
Sure. We'll have a word on it, sir. Definitely.
Yeah.
Right. And you observe most of the times when you're working for these kind of things, they provide, you know, you can say the list, the do's and don'ts of the things that you're supposed to do and not supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that's a point. But surely I'll share my insights too. Right. For the privacy aspect, in terms of laws also, we have a module for privacy, where we learn about some of the international laws, right? I mean, just as in general, because in India, the PDB bill is yet to come, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
In fact, the exam that I was preparing for, the reason the class was delayed for so much days was for that. In fact, I was preparing for Privacy Lead Accessor Certificate done by DSCI, Data Security Council of India.
Yes, I'm aware of it, yeah.
Right, so, I mean, I'll be sharing some of the privacy insights also regarding that.
Sure.
Right, because, sir, actually, the point is, the course is going and, you know, I hope till now you all are actually enjoying it, right? We are actually doing theory, but this all is actually, you know, if you could understand, if you can relate, this all makes up the base. And without this base, we cannot move ahead directly, right? Because there are a lot of terms then that, you know, comes in the mind, such as a corporate investigation or industrial espionage, right? So insider threats, wherein fraud management, I mean, fraud management is something regarding crime investigation, but in terms of corporate field, right? So that's the point. Anyways, I think our entire time went in case studies only, but the only purpose of giving you the case studies was not to actually, you know, tell you how the cases are solved. The cases can be solved in whatever ways you think. But the only reason for giving you these kind of case studies is to actually, improvise the ability to think critically. And to be honest, I also didn't thought a search history provider could, you know, this long method can be applied to solve up this kind of case. Right. So that's the only reason. And I hope there will be more case studies, you know, that I'm going to provide you, and you all will actually eagerly do it, right? Let me know everyone's opinion on these case studies. I mean, are they interesting? Are they anyway helping you all, I mean, in the course or something like that? You can just let me know in the chat, right? The only reason of providing case studies is to make understand that how the things are working on, you know, on real basis. On physical, on grounds. Make you think like an investigator. Using tools and, you know, anything can, anyone can do, right? What makes an investigator is through ability to think like an investigator. Not the tools, not the NIST framework and all. Sure, sir. I mean, it's okay. There are questions. Questions are important. Questions. Without questions, how can the course go up, right? Questions are important. Yes, so many assumptions are done. And that, yeah, sir, that's the reason in the world of cybercrime, assumption is done, right? And that, again, lies a thin line of difference between cybercrime and cyber forensics. Why? In cyber forensics, you cannot make assumptions straight away. Whatever you are doing using the tools, whatever the hash is there, that hash is there. Whatever evidence you have found in the recycle bin using the prefetch logs, you have found in the Windows. The straight away point is there. But cyber crime is full of assumptions. Assuming there is, you know, 50% probability to given to everything. It's completely based on assumptions, and using these assumptions, whatever the maximum outcome that, you know, is given from any of these assumptions is taken as a critical lead for solving up a case. And this habit of making assumptions is important as an investigator. That's it. That is what an investigator does, making assumptions. And in terms of making assumptions, then you have to trust nobody. Nobody means no one.
Actually, I'm remembering my first interview when I started my career 8 years back. I went to Delhi in a company, and it was my 8th round. Means like we were only 10 to 15 people were left over there. Then MD came, his brother and his father. So he took all the interviews, resume with him, and he started asking questions. He didn't ask anything. He just asked one question. Okay, there was a lady and she was dead. Why? So, you are talking about the assumption. You know, everyone giving the answers. okay, maybe it happened to her, it happened to that. Then he started giving some clues. Okay, I will tell you, like this lady was working in a circus. Then the whole point was like, you know, diverted to the circus. Okay, what kind of things can be happened in circus? Like someone doing jumping and it fall down, someone doing that, someone doing that. So he was actually checking who is actually going or reaching to the clue, like, you know, that in direction. So in that way, like, you know, in the end, the conclusion was like that lady was working in circus. And, you know, like there is a show which, like, you know, they will throw the knife. So in that time, her partner, actually, he throwed the knife towards her. And the knife actually, instead of hitting over the head, it was hit to her head directly. And she was dead. And the conclusion was like that day, that lady was actually wearing high heels instead of that lower one.
Okay.
So the way she was dead. But in the end, he told, he revealed a few things, but he was actually checking like who were reached over there. So apart from like all 100 people, he selected 3. I was the one of them. So I remember it was my first interview and how like, you know, tough it was. I remember it. Means I was not like, I just given few questions answer, because after that my mind actually says no, it's not possible. So maybe some other like, you know, qualities and all other they seen in the resume and then selected me.
Right.
That's very interesting actually.
Right. And actually the cyber crime field is made up of assumptions only.
Yes.
Right. It's completely based on assumptions. Sir, your writings, you know, there was a no clear picture in what direction I should think. There is no clear direction, in fact. You cannot judge any direction clear unless and until you get a lead out of it in cybercrime. You have to think in all directions, note down the all directions and wait till you get a lead from any of that direction. Right, exactly. So this is how actually the main intent was, you know, dealing with the case studies is to tell you that how, number one, you can think, and number two, how digital evidence is linked with general crime scene also. Right? I had been saying you since the start that today general crimes are also solved using digital, you know, artifacts. This is how they are related. See, a normal murder. Two murder cases, both are solved using cyber, right? Simple as that.
Actually, because I was reading news also. You remember like the Ambani's house, like they almost reached to the jail area now, because they traced that location, like, you know, the telegram was created nearby the the jail area, and from there, like, they sent this kind of threat message or memes they posted over there. So they even traced to via, I think, the tower locations.
Right. And tower locations is like only it can be done by police once again.
Yes. I think NIA and other investigation agency was involved in that. So like that is way beyond too much.
Right. I mean, there is an app available on Play Store known as Jazz Toolkit. Okay. Over there, if you have the authorities, right, they actually, the developers of the app, they actually give you the tower cell ID and all and all. The only the point is, you should be in a law enforcement agency.
And there is one more open source method for that. I think there is a, like, you know, database of
for all the cell towers. Right.
Yes. So that you can import over there and you can import it to your, like, you know, Google Map or somewhere.
Right.
So you can
then,
relate
sir,
it
again. What is the updation time of the database? Accuracy,
yeah, I
also.
Think, because I think there are some paid method also available. But I'm sure in perspective of India, I think it won't be helpful because...
Not at all.
I think, yeah. So Indian
only
data won't be.
Only law enforcement agencies, right.
Exactly. So most of the data which is available from the dump or hack forms or any other thing, they are actually not related to Indian continental. I searched many of them.
Right. And even if there is a risk of we are downloading the dump, and what if the dump itself is a virus?
Absolutely. That is the biggest risk.
Right. What is the name of that app? It's Jazz Toolkit. JASS, Jazz Toolkit. Okay. And you can just go through the Play Store for that. And I mean, in India, I'll tell you, digital fraud, e-wallet frauds, banking frauds, CDR, and anyone who can relate more concepts, these two or three main areas, banking fraud, e-wallet frauds, CDRs and all, tower IDs and all, can only be dealt by law enforcement agencies. No authority is given to any private investigative agency.
Okay, one more thing, like this question actually I'm having from long years, like, you know, I seen in many, even I attended so many seminars via, like, you know, from the many cyber, like cyber security experts. So this CRPC 91 actually I seen in many places, like one thing I know, like if it's like a missing or missing person case, the Google authorities and all these people, like, you know, they will be doing it very quickly. Suppose now, right, if you are submitting it today, and maybe by tomorrow they will give you the all details, maybe account activity. So how those people actually they are owner of private firms, or maybe they are working somewhere, because I seen two, three peoples, they were having that particular, that subpoena or maybe the PDF, and it was stamped by the, I think, Deputy Commissioner of Police. So how they can obtain, if they need any license for that, like for PI, if they are working privately?
Sir, see, basically in that case, if they are they have authorized to do so, compulsorily, mm-hmm, there will be some law enforcement agency or officer in charge assisting them.
Okay, so otherwise, they can take that.
They are not liable. Otherwise, they, mm-hmm, are not liable. They can take help. They can obviously take help, right? They can help, mm-hmm, take help to create the CRPC 91 notice, and the officer, mm-hmm, is just stamping and signing them.
Okay.
Right. Sir, we do have CRPC 91 notice with us in this course. We do have it. We're just going to,
I'm just
shade it off.
Yes.
Right. So, my senior, right, the senior, mm-hmm, over here at our company, he was been working as private investigator since quite a couple of years now. Recently, he left out.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And he was closely working with law enforcement agencies. And he was mainly into CDR, IPDR, and image processing. Right. So through that, you know, we have actually a provision of, you know, seeing some of those CDRs. CRPC.
Yes.
Right. So that could be the case, because otherwise there is no authority. In fact, first of all, even they do it, sir, the Google won't provide it.
Yeah, I know. I seen in many cases where actually YouTube and Google were rejected to remove such videos. In one of the case, I helped them. But it was like, you know, in different way, not like...
Now, sir, yeah, there are only three options, sir. Number one, yeah, is there a law enforcement, officer or agency in process, mm-hmm, with that PI office? Okay. Number, yes, two... The PI office is directly assisting the law enforcement agency in making the CRPC notice, and the agencies are just signing and stamping it off.
Mm-hmm.
Or number three, which could be the worst and the worst case, I'm not sure which agency you're talking about, but the worst, mm-hmm, and worst case could be they have already have taken some of CRPC 91 example.
Mm-hmm.
They have just taken the header and the footer with the stamp and the sign. Just they are changing the middle content.
I know very well about it. And I even found so many some of the websites actually, you know, what happened? There was some, you know, not kind of fraud website, but they actually stopped. They were posting some illegal content on their website. So somehow their database actually got dumped, and someone actually, you know, posted their old pictures and PDFs over there. In those PDFs, around... I found more than 20 notice, CRPC notice from different police, different states with stamp, okay, and everything. I found that time. It's been, I think, 4-5 years back. So I know very well these things are very, you know, common, and PDF editing is very easy these days. Like, it's not that hard. You can copy paste right. all these
but things. But I mean, we are pretty well sure. At least, you know, these kind of cases are very rare. You know, they are using the CRPC illegally, right?
Yes. It's, you know, I know very well because
0.001 of PI out of 10.
Mm-hmm.
Because the reason they are actually starting as a PI for helping others, right? So.
Yes, I understand that.
Right. So, anyways, that's all for today's class, right?
we took a lot of time.
No worries. I mean, it's okay. And tomorrow we'll probably complete the cybercrime laws and all. It will be a small topic. It could, you know, finish off fast. Let's see how it goes, right? Okay, I've already shared the material for tomorrow's class. Okay, so thanks a lot. Everyone for joining. Have a good day for outside India and have a good night for in India.
Okay. Good night.
Bye everyone. See ya. Thanks. Thanks a lot. Bye.